The history of herbal drugs, you know, by use of human herbs as a medicines, dates back to some 60,000 years ago. This is the information we got from the fossil records. That means you can imagine 60,000 years before people have used herbs, herbal drugs for the curative use. So it's amazing. So, you know, so such a so old medicinal system. And in India and China, our Ayurvedic system of medicine, Siddha, Siddharma medicine, and Chinese traditional medicines, you know, the documented records of herbal drugs date back to 5,000 years, you know, more than 5,000 years, I would say. So that means these herbs and herbal drugs have been used worldwide for so many, you know, diseases. For so long years, it has been tested on the people for so long years, and about 80% of the world populations are dependent on the plant-based system of medicine for their primary healthcare needs. I can imagine that 80% of the world population are dependent on the plant-based system of medicine for their primary healthcare needs. That means only 20% of the populations are, you know, using the our allopathic medicines. Their access of allopathic medicines are, I would put it in other words, rather than allopathic medicines are accessible only to the 20% of the population. Remaining 80% of the world is still dependent on, you know, herbal-based medicinal system. And medicinal plants contribute 80% of the raw materials in the traditional medical system. You take Ayurvedic system or Siddha system, Yunani, and you go for Chinese medicinal system and Japan, their system, and about 80% of their materials comes from the herbs only, medicinal plants. So this information, history, tells us that we have got a wonderful system of medicines in our hand, apart from the allopathic medicines, modern medicines, what we are using. And there's a lot of scope to, you know, utilize this system for the benefit of the human beings. Yeah, next slide, please. So coming to this topic, discovery of drug molecules from herbs, chronological data. So we have, as we have seen in the last slide, history of the herbal medicines, usage of herbal medicines. Since the mid-1980s, approximately 60% of the drugs have been derived from natural sources. This is not a matter of joke. 60% of the drugs have been derived from natural sources. That means they have got the lead molecules from the natural sources and they have developed into a modern allopathic medicines. From 1980s, 60%, only 40% are derived from the synthetic source. So 60% is really a big figure, right, in terms of, so herbal medicines, not only as a complex medicine or extracts or tinctures, homeopathic medicines, they, you know, benefit the mankind, but also indirectly they benefit the mankind by providing the lead molecules from which we can, the modern synthetic allopathic medicines, a synthetic chemist can develop a molecule, synthesize the molecule and develop it as a drug. So it's doing a dual purpose there. So, and chronologically, if you see that morphine was, discovered in 1804, and then the vinca alkaloids, everybody, all of us know that vinca alkaloids from Catharanthus roscius used for anti-cancer agents. It's developed in 1950. And also the recently paclitaxel from the bark of Texas Bavifolia, 1967, and so many molecules. So it's just only few examples. I have known examples I have given you here. So this is the examples of that I told you. 60% of the deaths have been derived from natural sources. No, like this, the chronologically they have developed many molecules. You know, artemisinin, you take anything. Almost 50% of all approved new drugs were based on natural products between the year 1994 and 2007. So one should underline this one. Between 1994, yeah, please go back to the old one. Between 1994 and 2007, 50% of all approved new drugs were based on natural product. So how is, you can see the contribution of this herbal field, the different various system of medicines in developing the allopathic medicines also here. Yeah, please go to the next slide. Coming back to such a, we have a, such a great vast potential there, you know, from the Hubble Red. Like we have a Ayurvedic, in India, I'm talking about our Indian potential. We have Ayurveda, Siddha and Unani system of medicines, and also these systems, you know, have a great potential as a whole medicines, as a formula, complex formulations also, extracts also. And also we can take a, we can find a lead molecules, we can identify the lead molecules and develop develop it as a allopathic medicines. So it's a great thing we have, but what if we, being in this industry for past 25 years, what is my feeling is that we are not utilizing this Ayurvedic, our own Ayurvedic and the Siddha system of medicine to the fullest potential. That's what we feel, no? Because the problem is that it's a lack of proper scientific evidence. We are doing business in multinational companies, we are exporting to US and other companies. The regulatory agencies and even the customers, first the question they ask is that whether you have a clinical trial report for your product. Whatever product you are exporting or marketing, if you want to market in abroad countries, the first question they ask is that whether you have a, you know, clinical trials that have been conducted with the modern accepted scientific protocols. So you have a data of your product, whether your product is working or not, that's the first question they ask. And then they go for, you know, standardization, whether your product is standardized properly using the modern analytical tools. So that's the second thing they look for, you know. And the third thing is that they go for the safety profiles. Safety profiles means you have all the toxicity data and then heavy metals and microbial contents in your product. So these are the things they look for. So for our system of medicine, most of the Ayurvedic system of medicines and formulations and tinctures and elixirs, you take anything, even the individual extracts. We have a wonderful system of medicine, but we don't have complete profiling, whatever I have mentioned now, clinical trial report, standard, proper standardization with the modern analytical tools, and then the, you know, safety, and then your heavy metals and microbiological data, and pesticides also. They look for the pesticide analysis, aflatoxins. These are all the additional requirements some regulatory bodies want. So we don't have a proper data, but particularly the first one, clinical trial data is missing. The beauty of our system of medicine is that we know that our system, our drugs, Ayurvedic drugs and natural products have been tested on human beings by our Ayurveda acharyas long, long ago. And they have, today's in today, if you want to develop a drug, we have to go systematically. First, you have to do it on in vitro experiments, and then you go for in vivo screenings on small animals, and then go to the primate screening, and then go to the clinical trials. These are the various steps involved in today's drug development. But in the olden days, these steps are not available to them. So they directly applied these medicines, tested these medicines on human beings. And they are all time tested, human beings tested, and safety tested, everything they are tested. But the documentation, proper documentation, which the modern community needs, you know, the scientific documentation is lacking. Because of this lacking, we could not take this our ancient system of medicines to the population around the world. We are doing it, but still it needs a lot more improvements and a lot more data, backup data, to take it to the fullest extent. So coming back to the herbal drug development in the past, you know, I'm going to give you a brief problems we have faced in the past in doing the herbal drug development. Because you all know that herbal drugs, herbs are complex in nature. The matrix, we call it as, is a very complex in nature. They contain more than hundreds and even thousands of compounds. A single herb contains more than hundreds and thousands of compounds. So for developing a lead molecule from identifying and developing a lead molecule from herbal drug is really a tedious task in olden days. Because you have to, you know, first you have to identify the bioactive fractions, which fraction has got the bioactivity by doing bioactivity graded fractionation studies, which involves, you know, precipitation method, isolation of the bioactives I'm talking about, solvent precipitation, conventional column chromatographic methods, and then once you got the pure compound, you then check the purity, and then you identify the compound using the spectroscopic method by using mass, NMR, and IR spectroscopic methods. And once you identify the molecules, and then you go for pharmacological, toxicological, ADME, and all the kind of screenings, which is very time involving and time consuming, and also the very intense labor and resource consuming. Resource in the sense I'm telling both finance and manpower. So all these things takes quite a long time to come out with the one active bioactive molecules. And the pharmacological screening also, pharmacological screening, you have to do it on in vitro and in vivo models only those days. So and you go for structure activity relationship studies and all, modify the identified purified molecules here and there, attach change the functional groups here and there, and attach some substituents here and there, and then see their pharmacological activities, ADME properties, all those things. So which took a lot of time and a lot of effort from the natural product scientists. And then once the molecule has been identified, then if the molecule shows the desirable bioactivity and safety profile, everything, then the synthetic chemist part comes and he designs the synthetic methods for that molecule, and the scale up and everything goes to the market, clinical trials, everything, it goes on like that. It is not like I told, it is not as easy hearing these things. It needs, in the isolation of the compound itself, takes a lot of time. You have to do recolumn in the conventional methods, olden days I'm telling, and then you have to get a pure compound, and when the purity of the compound has to be established, and then you have to identify the molecule, and then bioactivity screenings and all, toxicity screenings, and that takes a lot of time. So that's why we got the lead molecules, and then it could not be so fast, and then not many people also involved in this because of the difficulties involved in this finding out a lead molecule from a herbal drugs. Please go to the next slide. And now the current scenario is entirely changed. Not only these, the available instruments also. In the olden days, we have a lot of limitations on the analytical instruments also. The first thing is that the analytical instruments were not available everywhere. If you want to do LC-MS, MS studies, I do not know the MS, MS studies, GC-MS, MS and all, you have to go to the different places, you have to, the person has to run here and there, and the even the highly sophisticated instruments with the latest softwares which are available, artificial intelligence, we are talking about, the topics of the session. So those are not available on those days. The limited availability only was there. With that, we have to do a lot of studies. But coming to the current scenario, it is entirely changed. So the herbal drug industry has entirely changed. Maybe 10 years before, in our, I would say that in our industrial background, even 15 years, I would say I'd go to 20 years. 20 years before, if you're introducing a herbal dietary supplement also into a US market was a tremendous, tedious task. You cannot take a herbal ingredient or dietary supplement into the US market because people don't believe whether really these herbal drugs are going to work or not, and we are doing really. But the scenario has changed quite a lot between these 20 years. Now the entire people are looking towards herbal medicines, herbal drugs, and they have got a quite confidence in our products and all. The reason is that the people started believing in herbal drugs is that the herbal drugs, when they took for their own problem, it started working, and people came again and started purchasing it. And that's how the entry happened, because the different regulatory authorities, they were not allowing to this type of ingredient to enter into US market. these available modern scientific instruments, you know, where the modern HPLC is coupled with the MAS, GC coupled with MAS, and then the softwares, libraries, available instruments, and the even the, for the isolation also, we have got a more sophisticated instrument like flash chromatographies, automated flash chromatographies, and then preparatory HPLCs. All these instruments, with the help of the software and libraries, helped us to develop data, scientific data for these products in a much more acceptable way. And that's how the story started, and people started accepting our herbal medicines all over the world. And we have, I think, in the past 20 years, really we have done a good job, you know, taking some of our wonderful medicines, wonderful system of medicines around the world, like Ashwagandha. Now it's known to the world, you know, it's, and it is one of the fast moving product in the world, and the main supplier of Ashwagandha extract or Ashwagandha based medicine is India. Only we should be proud of ourselves having such a wonderful you know, ingredient from our country, has been used by all around the world for mainly the anti-stress and adaptogenic properties. So likewise, amla, the other things we have introduced in the amla, amla is doing a great job, and people have started accepting all over the world. And Shilajit, you can name it now. Now Chebula, Belerica, and Ayurvedic ingredients and medicines are now started. People started believing in the directions. So this all happened because of the, you know, this development in the field of analytical instrument and the softwares and the artificial intelligence, you know, integrating these instruments with the softwares and the database systems. All these things have developed, and we could easily do, because previously we used to it used to take a lot of time for isolating a compound and identifying the compound. But now with the availability of like LC-MS, MS, and GC-MS, MS, you can just inject the sample into the LC-MS, MS, and then within I think 1 or 2 hours you can identify all the spectrum of compound based on their molecular weight and then fragmentation pattern. Likewise, GC-MS, volatile, for volatile compounds you can go for GC-MS, MS analysis. At least you can know that the molecule is there, and by their fragmentation and reactive ion monitoring status and all, you can identify the molecules very quickly, because a lot of database is also available. These systems not only they come as a only instrument, but they come out with the as a software with the library or database system. So immediately you can match with the available database. That lot of available database is also available. So you immediately you can hit and match the compound you are looking for. And if you know the chemistry, structural identifications, you can, based on their fragmentation pattern, you can identify the molecules, and then you can confirm it by other spectroscopic methods also. So you need not to waste a lot of time like that. And once if you have a with available flash chromatography and preparatory HPLC methods, once you purify, you can also purify the compound of interest very quickly, and then you get the, you can know the purity and identity of the molecule. And really these systems are doing wonderful help for us in developing the herbal bioactives, that means herbal medicines, herbal bioactives. And these data also, the generated data which we are generating from these instruments, are scientifically validated and accepted by the community throughout the world. So you don't have any problem of you don't have a proper data, backup data or not. Second thing is, now all the places, almost the premier institutions in our CSI institutions, NIPERS, and you take any places, almost they have got these instruments, availability of these instruments. So with this background resources available, so we can now fastly move on to the herbal drug development, and then we can take these medicines to the all around world, and standardization also become very easy now. So once you identify the molecule, then previously, previously also it was available to some extent only on the, you go to the database and you structure activity assay or softwares, and then even the other ligand binding and all those things softwares are available at that time with a limited accessibility and limited resources. But now, if you for the herbal drugs also, herbal drugs, natural flavonoids, you take flavonoids, phenolics, or tetrapins, xanthones, you take any kind of any class of compounds, you get now the, you know, what is their probable target of action information from the various databases. And this is where the artificial intelligence came into picture, you know. In this direction, even though we have got a very good system of medicines, Chinese have really gone step further into this. They are developing their own database, you know, traditional Chinese medicine ID and TCM database at Taiwan. Target and for the compound itself, for the plants itself, if you take they have enumerated n number of plants in their database, and if you click on that, you will get the information of the bioactive constituents which are present in there. And once you have that information, the compound name and everything, you can go to any database on the Chembase or you know ChemDraw, like that. You can go to that and get the 3D structure, and then you can go to the target identification next. Once you know the molecule, and you have to find out the target of the molecules. In the previous days, we used to do a lot of screening studies, a lot of biochemical studies, a lot of you know protein studies and all, you know, to find out the target of action, where the molecule is sitting, which protein is upregulated, which protein is downregulated. Really, you have to do the experiment and find out. But now, with the available of such a data, you don't have to go to the lab at all. You sit on the system in front of the computer and put the 3D structure molecule, and this database system will tell you that these are the possible targets. You know, it is going to hit this protein, this protein, this protein, and so you can get an idea, basic idea. Okay, this is a flavonoid molecule, routine. This is going to hit. These are all the targets we are looking for. Okay, antioxidant enzyme, it is upregulating, superoxidizer, catalase, whatever it is upregulating. So you got the information, basic information readily without going into the lab. This is the, you know, such a boon in disguise, you know, you have the, previously what will, it will be happen in retroways. First you screen the drug, take the molecule and screen it for activity, and once you get the activity and go back and see the, what mechanism it is acting, what kind of pathways it is, you know, influenced by this molecule. All those things you have to really do molecular biology studies and all. Cell culture studies, go for molecular biology mechanisms, you know, Western blotting, Northern blotting, all those things. But nowadays, it is available of this database, without going into all those things, at least you can see that these are all the pathways which are getting affected by these molecules, altered, yeah, whether it is upregulated or downregulated by these molecules. And once the target is known, so there's another software which are available, which can link the target to the various diseases. Okay, this protein, if it is upregulated, what is going to happen? What is the end effect of that, you know, upregulation? It is going to increase the disease or decrease the disease. Those kind of information also now available for the herbal drugs, I am telling. So now, see, this is for allopathic medicines, it is already there. They have been developing. But herbal drugs, recently, they have done a lot of work in this direction, and the database has been developed. And in this one, Chinese people, Chinese traditional medicine system, pharmacology database. So an analysis platform they have created, and they have gone a little further ahead of us. So it's a lot more work we have to do in this direction also, because we have a very wonderful, I'm repeating again and again, we have a very good, such a wonderful Ayurvedic and Siddha and Yunani system of medicines. We have got a very good resource, but we have to put it, we have, I think, scatterly, we have all the information also. Maybe a lot of people are working on that, and a lot of good works are coming from good people, you know, around the India or nation. But we have to compile that and put it in one platform, like these Chinese people, and then, you know, it will be easy for other people to immediately access and validate our claim and whatever information we are generating from this. Next slide, please. So this is an example I have taken from Journal of Chem Informatics, from the publication I was talking, information I have gathered from that. So you can see that how they have, you know, systematically they have done this thing, compound informations. So linked to public, they have linked already structure properties, ADME properties, they have, and then target information also, linked to the drug bank, target name, everything. This is for herbal drug I'm talking. I'm not talking about allopathic medicine. So they have done in a very nice way, and then they have linked the diseases also. First is the molecule, and then the target, and then the disease. How nicely they have done a compound screening of a herb. If you type the herb name, then it will show you that what are all the constituents which are present in that herb, and what are then it will link it to your target site. You can see that this molecule is acting on this target, this molecule is acting on this target, like that. And then the disease, this target, if it is altered, then what will be the disease it is going to be, and for what kind of disease you are looking, what kind of disease you are looking at target molecule, your target compound, you can easily identify. And then you can, once you have this all this preliminary information, then you can go to the lab studies to confirm them. So this will save a lot of time, lot of resource, and lot of energy also, so this is really a important, very good tool. Not only this is the Chinese people have developed. Even we are also not back. We are also doing a great job. So NIPAR Kolkata already such a visionary person, Dr. Ravichandran, already installed LC-MS MS with the protein software for the target identification. So you can, if you have a extract with you, you can take it to the NIPAR Calcutta, and they will do a profiling of your extract or a herbal formulation, and the molecules, you can identify the molecules based on their, as I told you earlier, the mass and the fragmentation pattern, and they have high resolution MS-MS, HR-MS-MS, that's a Q-TOF I'm talking about. So you can precisely, very accurately identify the molecule, and then you can go to the you can immediately link the molecule properties, chemical properties, to the database, protein target database, and then you can identify the various targets which have been altered by this molecule, and then you can focus your activity on those targets, and you can see that whether you are whatever target you are looking and whatever diseases you are looking for, the molecule you are looking for, whether it is fitting into that or not. So things have become made very easy. And then NIPAR Kolkata is having this facility. You see, it is available to your next door. So which will save a lot of time, and you will get a lot of information about this, and then you can design your work based on that. And then you can go to the lab work, lab pharmacology, lab work, and pharmacological studies, and even for the toxicological also, since you have the data like these, toxicological properties and everything, you can get a first-hand information, basic information from these softwares. Whatever information developed till now, you can get a very good information on that. And then you can work on that in your lab. You can confirm that, you can validate it by doing the final animal studies, and then going for further clinical studies and all those things. So this is these are all the beauty of this artificial intelligence, how the artificial intelligence is helping us as a scientist in finding out a new drug molecule from a natural product or a synthetic molecule. Next slide, please. So this is also I have taken from the Chinese traditional Chinese medicines software. So how they have profiling it, how they are putting it further, first 200 ingredients they have screened, and then from that 69 active compounds they got, and then there from the database they have got the which are the targets those compounds are really affecting it, and then the from the targets disease linking, which are the diseases those targets are going to affect. So those informations they have done, and then they have developed the software based system very nicely, and then this helps us in a very lot helps us in a lot way to proceed in a much quicker way, and in a better way. You save a lot of your time as a scientist and drug developer. You can save a lot of time, you can get a lot of ingredients, a lot of information about the mechanism of actions, about the protein interactions and the gene level interactions. So all those informations you get by sitting on the system and putting the information together, you get every information. So and then you can plan in a precisely nicely way, and then you can go for the confirmatory experiments in the lab. Yeah, next slide, please. Next slide. We'll come back to this slide afterwards, please. The next slide. I think this is, I missed one slide here. So I'll, no problem. I'll tell you openly. See, this we were all talking about the molecule now. Molecule, how the artificial intelligence and databases are, helping the developing a new molecule, a new drug molecules, a lead molecule in a faster way to bring the drug into the market. But not only the molecule, single molecule, but this database system helps us helps in complex formulations also. That's where the beauty lies in. People always, you guys also heard about when you say that, oh, I have this herbal compound, this action, this this cues, this disease, this cues, this disease. Take any number. Yeah, this compound is very, very, very good in the it has got very good anti-diabetic properties. It has got very good antioxidant properties. And if you tell the people would laugh, oh, you have a compound and you are telling it has got all the activities. How is it possible? So easy. You can have only one activity. How you are telling? So you are just bluffing like that. People used to have in the past mentality. We have interacted when we used to tell them no. It is not like that. We have to convince. You have to show lot of produce lot of data to convince them. In olden days, you have to do the experiments. You have to develop evidence, and then you have to go for clinical trials, prove them on clinical patients, and then tell them. Then only they will listen to you first. But now the situation scenario is entirely changed because with the help of this system pharmacology and this databases, all these databases, if you take any complex formulations, I'll start from my single herb. First, take any herb, single herbs. Say, for example, ashwagandha, you take it. Ashwagandha, Vedanya Swami for unknownness. If you take that herb, with the chemical information, the analytical work that has been done, based on that, we know that this plant contains citadel glycosides, eugenol glycosides, and the oligosaccharides. These two are the major bioactive flavonoids. These two, flavonoids are present only in the trace amounts, but main are the eugenol glycosides and oligosaccharides. These two are the major bioactive ingredients. So now you have the information from the database and the literature that that these are the chemical compounds. Eugenol glycosides contains many number of aminosaccharides, 4, 5, 6, like that it goes. And oligosaccharides, you have fructooligosaccharides. So once you know the compound, you can pull out the structure from any available database, 3D structure, and then put on this database. It will immediately show this, okay, these pathways are affected. See how it is showing the anti-stress adaptogenic activity. So it is affecting this neurotransmitters pathway. So, excitatory neurotransmitter, dopamine, adrenaline, these pathways are upregulated, and then FIST pathways are downregulated. All those informations are, you're going to get within a fraction of seconds by putting the information on the softwares. So likewise, oligosaccharides, how it is doing the immunomodulatory property. So this is affecting the, immune T cells, B cells, B lymphocytes, and then you have got antibodies, antigens, all those pathways, it will show where it is upregulated, where it is being downregulated. So the correlation, they have such a nicely, they are developing, and you can get the information. And with all this information data, you go to a customer and tell them, no, I have developed a product and it is acting on both immunological system and it is also acting on the CNS as anti-stress adaptogenic. By believing, they will, by seeing, they will believe it. So such a wonderful work has been done on with the help of these databases. So see, this is for the single plant I told. So when Ayurvedic complex formulation comes, like it is having 4 or 5 plant, more than 5 plant materials, there the situation is more difficult, more complex, So one plant itself contains more than hundreds of compounds. If the 5 plant, if you think about it, will contain more than 500 of compounds. So then how you are going to tackle? So this was also one of the problem in the past in the national product industry. If you go to the Western countries and tell them that I have a formulation, this works better in this for this condition, but the ingredients are 5 or 10, they'll say that, no, I don't want this formulation, you take and go. Simply they will say, because how you are going to standardize these complex formulations and how you are going to create evidence that this compound is working. Okay, finally, final effect, but how this complex formulation is doing that effect? That is, we are talking about target site and then the mechanism of actions, all those things are difficult to establish for this complex formulation. But with the advancement of the system pharmacology, artificial intelligence database, software systems, this has made a lot more easy our job. Because if you have a complex formulation also, by your chemical available sophisticated instruments, you can easily figure out what are the type of compounds, class of compounds which are present there, like flavonoids. Okay, this formulation contains major bioactives, tetrapin, glycosides, yes, saponins, yes, flavonoids. These are the major bioactive group of compounds which are present in this plant. And from that, you take one lead molecules, identify the one lead molecules from each group and put them on the database, and then you see that which are all the pathways which are going to be affected. And you can get the evidence, you know, for that, okay, these are all the pathways which are going to affect it. That's why we are getting this action, target action, the desired action we are looking for. So give this information to the customer. The customer will be very happy, you know, so they will accept immediately your product, and your product is going to be released into the market, and you are taking your own system to the broad market, international market. That's how these artificial systems are, you know, helping us today. Being in the herbal product industry, we are just started using this system. I would say that there are a lot more ways to go. We have to develop a lot more data, a lot more pathways and interactions. We have to has to be generated from our scientists all over the world. I think people are working on these directions. This is the one of the important point. Coming back to here, I have presented one paper, the human skeletal muscle transcriptome response to oral shilajit supplementation. See, this is the one of the study where we really, you know, got the benefit of this software database systems and the artificial intelligence, which helped us to find out a new target of action for the shilajit. I would say that shilajit is, you all know that it's one of the Ayurvedic rasayana. It is used as the rejuvenator. Rejuvenator means energy booster. And we are marketing this product, you know, from past 15 years in the US market. And people are, you know, getting benefited by taking this subject. This product is known to boost the energy. Energy means ATP synthesis. I'm talking ADP, ATP synthesis. And there's a belief in our Ayurvedic system of medicines. If you take shilajit, you will have also have an anti-aging effects. The olden saints and all who were roaming in the Himalayas and other places, they used to consume the shilajit and they live long, you know, without eating any food and all those things, because the shilajit is such a wonderful medicine. Apart from these, we got information also. The military personnel who are all, you know, staying in the high altitude mountain areas, Himalayas and those things, they used to, you know, using their gun, they used to shoot the shilajit pellets which are hanging on the rock, and then they used to eat the shilajit for their, you know, surviving at that cold conditions and all those things, and they feel better. They felt better after taking shilajit. All those data are available. So these are known already. These are known in the Ayurveda, and nothing new in these things. It's a very good Ayurvedic rasayana. That's why it's called one of the best rasayana in Ayurveda. But when we started working on that, we did a lot of clinical trials on you know, energy, ATP synthesis, all those things, laboratory trials, clinical trials and things. Finally, what we did was, we did one study in Ohio State University Medical Center on clinical human populations. We wanted to find out the ATP levels before exercise and after exercise, what happens to the ATP synthesis and the energy levels and all those things, related pathways. And we were doing these studies. Go to the next slide, please. So in this study, what happened was we were doing the RT-PCR using the ECM-related genes derived from microanalysis. It's a gene chip array technology we have used. Orally, we have administered the shilajit to the patients, and we took the biopsy samples from the skeletal muscles, and then we processed it, and we analyzed the gene variations. You know, our original motive was to find out the ATP and the energy pathways, what happens to that. With that idea, we did the designed the experiment, and we did the experiments. Fortunately, what we got was in the study, we found that there are many fold increase of the certain genes were observed. and even says more than 1,000 times also. Some genes were more 1,000 times, 1,000 fold increase. Some genes were 200 fold increase, like that. Remarkable increase in the upregulation of the certain genes were found. And we identified those genes, what are those genes, and found that those genes are related to the collagen synthesis. So upregulation of genes means upregulation of collagen synthesis. And once collagen synthesis, I told Schlagit is known for anti-aging, I told you in the beginning. So anti-aging, the wrinkles in the skin and elasticity of the joints and everything, collagen plays an important role. And we found that for the first time that the Schlagit formulation upregulates the collagen synthesizing genes, and then it was really a new discovery for us. So this could be possible because of this artificial intelligence and advancement of the databases and technology only. Without this, it is really impossible. You have to go do the animal studies and everything, find out. Really, this was the target which we were not looking for. We were looking for ATP synthesis, ATP levels and that thing. But this came out as a boon in disguise, And then we got the patent on this, US patent on our findings, and we are promoting Schlagit for that activity now. So that's how this database helps us in a big way. I just wanted to present a case study for you guys, how this we are getting the benefit of this modern development and database and artificial intelligence and the network pharmacology systems. Please go to the next slide. I missed there is a conclusion slide also. In the conclusion, I would say that this modern developments with the systems pharmacology and then the modern database system, whatever we are discussing on this, they really help us in quickly identifying the lead molecules from the herbal drugs, herbal herbs and medicinal plants, and then identifying the target action of that lead molecule, which are the target that are affected by the lead molecules, and then linking that targets to the associated diseases, and then finding out the diseases related to that, whether this is going to cure that disease or it is going to aggravate the disease, or toxicity, like that. This modern database with the system, with the help of the system and softwares, you can do these magic things with the available tools. I think I have given you a brief outline about how this artificial intelligence and the system pharmacology and modern database systems are helping us in drug development from herbal drugs. And we have another speakers who are also would have explained about the allopathic medicines, how these systems are helping. Basically, the procedure is same. The raw material, that's the starting product, is different. So with this, I thank you everybody for patiently listening me for almost 1 hour, and I thank the organizers also for giving me an opportunity for sharing my thoughts with you guys. Thank you very much.